Welcome back, 4:30. It is week two in the federal tax fraud trial of Orleans Parish District Attorney Jason Williams.
Williams and his law partner, Nicole Burdette, are facing tax fraud charges. Joining us live, former federal prosecutor Sean Toomey. Sean, as always, thanks for being here.
Sean, we heard in Aubrey's report earlier today, he said that the prosecution, the government, getting ready to rest its case. I mean, I've just been keeping up casually, but have we seen a smoking gun here in this case?
You know, we really haven't. You know, the tax preparer testified early in the trial, and we were thinking that was going to be their star witness. It didn't happen. And since then, they've just been putting on witness after witness, really emphasizing the same points, that these deductions on their face are really absurd. But no, nothing to directly tie Jason to any of it.
You made this comment earlier. A lot of this evidence is circumstantial. If you could explain that, I know we all think we know what that means, but a jury could bring back guilty on circumstantial evidence if they choose.
That's right, right. There's two different types of evidence, direct evidence and circumstantial evidence. The first, you know, it's watching someone do something, a recording of them saying something. Circumstantial evidence requires you to make an inference. And that's really what the evidence in this case is. It's requiring the jury to say, look, based on everything we've seen, we're going to infer that he had to have known that these deductions were fraudulent and made that intentional filing.
But and I'm sure it happens all the time, a jury can get to beyond reasonable doubt with a circumstantial evidence.
Absolutely. Beyond a reasonable doubt simply means that the judge is going to instruct the jury that they have to have the same amount of confidence in their verdict as they do for every important decision in their lives, like buying a house or getting married. And you can do that with circumstantial evidence.
I'm going to harken back to the Bill Jefferson case here back in 2009, where it was hung, not guilty, guilty. Mm-hmm. Is it possible to see something like this on all these counts where the jury makes varying decisions of guilty, not guilty, hung jury, not to put the cart before the horse, but is this the kind of case where you could see a lot of different verdicts on different charges?
Absolutely. The jury has to be unanimous. All 12 jurors have to be in agreement that there's a guilty verdict or an innocent verdict as to each and every count. So up and down the line and as to each defendant. So we could have a split verdict here on numbers of levels.
I mean, there's the chance Nicole Burdette could be found innocent or guilty, and Jason could be the opposite on some of these charges. Here's the big question that Jeannie and I feel like we want to know. Does Jason Williams take the stand in his own defense at this point in the trial?
Right, that's always the hardest decision for a defendant to make. That's a decision that has to be his and his alone with the advice of his attorneys. When this trial started, I assumed he'd testify. Jason is comfortable on his feet. He's obviously a skilled trial lawyer. He's a politician. So he's used to being under the spotlights. But as this trial's unfolded, I'm starting to second guess that. The government hasn't, again, as you pointed out, brought out a real smoking gun here. So it's going to be a much harder, closer call, I think, than it was at the start of the trial.
All right.
No. Great insight, Sean. We appreciate it. We'll see you tomorrow, and we'll see if the prosecution does, in fact, rest its case today or on Tuesday.
Thank you for being here. You can count on WDSU to bring you the latest developments in the trial on air and on all of our digital platforms until a verdict is reached. That includes live tweets from federal court.